Right, good afternoon everyone and welcome to this week's Southwest Hearts Link for Growth TV show. As usual, you can contact us via Twitter at L4GSWHearts, that's via Twitter at L4GSWHearts. We'd love to hear from you if you've got any views or thoughts on the show or want articles included in future weeks. We have got the full team back this week. I know I promised it last week, but there was a last minute dropout. But this week we've got a full team. We've even brought in a couple of extra players to help us out. Tania is here back with the news. Hi, Tania.
Hello, Diane. Yeah, got loads of news, important local stuff, new buildings, small grants for local things, and shaping our local services.
Okay. One of the extra team players on the on today's show is a gentleman called David Mills, who launched a new initiative called Kidscape last night. Hi, David, and welcome to the show.
Hi, thank you very much. Yeah, I'm going to be talking a little bit about Kids Create, which is an initiative designed to empower young people to start taking action on improving things in their local community and the wider world.
Okay, that sounds really interesting. We look forward to that interview a bit later on. And Chris, you're going to be interviewing some Iron Gates.
Yeah, I get all the great jobs, don't I? So, yeah, I'm not expecting a big dialogue, but I'm going to see whether the what we've paid for the development of the top of Cassiobury Park is all that, actually. I'll tell you a bit more later on. Yeah, you have to wait for it.
Okay, great. And Neil, you've got a whole load of sport for us.
Yes, I've got some... breaking news about scandal at Watford FC. Got local football, rugby, and boxing, and golf.
Okay, that sounds really good. And Catherine, being Halloween and fireworks season, there's quite a lot happening this week in locally.
There certainly is, Diane. We've got Halloween, we've got fireworks, we've got a warning about keeping pets indoors during fireworks, and then we move very swiftly on to Santa's for Santa dashes. Lots of charity news coming up, lots of things going on at the Palace and at Watford Coliseum as well. Tune in and you'll find out all about it a bit later on.
Okay, that sounds really good. Link for Growth in the past week in Southwest Arts held 5 events. Earlier on today, there was a link for help at the kitchen in Croxley Green, where Catherine and Chris and a few other people turned up to offer help and advice to anyone who needed it about starting a new business or if they had an internet issue or something like that. There was hopefully a team down there to make it all happen and to solve your problems. Last night, there was a link for business at the Fresh Shop in Market Street. This is the Watford link for business. The Rippensworth one took place last week. But last night it was, as I said, link for business in Watford. Yesterday morning there was link for coffee at LJ's Coffee House in Oxy, which is opposite Bushy Station. And then we'll be talking more about LJ's Coffee House later on, won't we, Catherine? Yeah, okay, Catherine's not there.
I'm here. Gosh, you surprised me and caught me out there. Yes, indeed, we will be talking more about LJ's Coffee House later on.
I was just checking that you were keeping up.
Well, clearly I wasn't, but I am now.
And there were 2 events on Monday. There was a coffee in the evening, a link for coffee in the evening at Reason, and a morning coffee at Cafe Loco in Northwood on Monday. Again, all these events are regular Link for Growth events, and it's a great opportunity for you to meet people, to discuss ideas and to see how you can help the community or how the community of people involved with Link for Growth can possibly help you. As I said at the start of the show, and as David intimated, we have David Mills, who is, some of you may know from seeing the Link for Growth education program. David is a former teacher and is currently a life coach, working with both parents and kids, and is also a singer. And we're going to be talking to David about his new initiative called Kids Create, which was launched last night at the kitchen. Hi, David, and welcome to the show.
Thank you, Diane. Pleasure to be here.
Perhaps you could tell us a little bit about what Kids Create is.
So it was Albert Einstein, I believe, who said that our problems cannot be solved with the same level of consciousness that created them. And what I've found is adults tend to be very much stuck in a certain mindset, whereas children are far more open-minded And it's always, I never cease to amaze me, their imagination and their creativity. So what, a couple of years ago, I had a group of children come to me with this idea of creating. They were being home educated, and it was an idea to create a prom for their local home education community. And I said, you know what, I'll help you do this, but you're going to do it all. You're going to do all the organizing. You'll phone around the venues and you'll negotiate on price. You'll sort out the sound and lighting equipment. You'll go shopping in the supermarkets for plates and cutlery, et cetera, et cetera. You'll design, you'll write speeches. You'll decide on what will be the prices, the dress code, et cetera, et cetera. That was how the whole idea started off, because it was such a huge success, what I did with this group of kids. And they surprised themselves at what they were able to achieve and the life skills that they learned during the process. So that from that, I've been working on this idea of introducing kids create spaces. And we're initially, we decided to start providing them in coffee shops, because these are very much, I view them as safe meeting points. And the idea is that the children are empowered to work on innovating, so it's real life projects in the real world. So for example, during yesterday's first meetup, which just could not have gone any better, we had six children there, and the theme that they seemed to latch onto the most was helping the homeless or reaching out to the lonely. So that's the topic that I want to address. We're going to keep it at a local level initially, so we'll be reaching out to the residents of the Croxley Green area. But yeah, it's very much about empowering children. It's they're in charge. I'm there as a facilitator to say, right, what do you want to do to improve things in your community? And here's a space in which you are empowered to take, not just to discuss ideas, but actually take action on those ideas. So that's it in a nutshell.
Okay, so what do you think the long-term benefits for the children are going to be?
What I found as a former school teacher is that the school system can, for many kids, completely squash their natural curiosity, love of learning, and their innate creativity and imagination. So what I'm doing is feeding into that. And what I found, speaking to children, well, hundreds of children that I've coached, both within institutions, schools, and various youth projects and one-to-one over the years, is that they're crying out for an opportunity to be heard. But in the context of the existing mainstream school system, there just aren't the forums or platforms on which children can stand and actually speak their truth and have their voices heard. And I think that's a terrible, terrible shame. So what we're really doing is we're trying to tap into that innate passion and creativity and imagination in the kids, because they're the ones that hold the future of this planet in their hands. Well, certainly from my perspective.
Okay, and is this going to remain a local initiative, or will it eventually spread out around the country or around the district?
Well, Diane, the dream is to see it spread throughout the whole of the UK, and we're going to be targeting coffee shops initially. So we're wanting to get 1,000 independent coffee shops on board. What that means is I'm going to have quite a key role in terms of training up adults to hold space, because that's one of the biggest challenges for adults wanting to support. It's not about imposing our own agenda on the kids. It's about truly listening and holding space, and trust is such a huge thing. And what I've found over the years is that a lot of people, particularly if they've grown up through that system and they're living in what I sometimes call the box or the matrix of conditioning, is that it's difficult to break out of that and actually trust yourself enough to be able to trust a group of 9 to 13-year-old kids in front of you to actually take action on their ideas. So that's going to be a pivotal part of its success, is finding suitable facilitators.
Okay, so the Croxley group, how often are they going to meet?
We're going to be meeting initially fortnightly, once every 2 weeks.
Okay, and
we're going to probably be going for a Wednesday. We did meet on a Thursday this week, but because several members of the group, that wasn't going to quite work. Probably going to be a Wednesday evening, but that's to be confirmed.
Okay, and of course you'll be putting lots of publicity out through Linda and the Link for Growth websites and forums and Facebook pages, etc. Yes,
I shall do my utmost, yes, to promote it.
Great. Very briefly, as I said, you also promote the Link for Growth Education Show. When's the next issue, and will you be discussing this in more detail then?
The next education show is on this next Wednesday. During that show, I'm actually going to be interviewing, fingers crossed, a 12-year-old who's currently in school, but she's an extraordinary individual with some amazing ideas about what we could do to improve education. So that was going to be the focus of the next show. I will, though, in time, be bringing on some of the members of this initial Croxley group, Kids Create, committee. One 13-year-old boy in particular is very keen to come on and talk about that. So, yes, that is coming in due course.
Okay, well, thank you for that, David. Good luck with your initiative. And we'll hopefully be talking to you at some point in the future about how great it's been and your expansion plans for the rest of South West Hearts.
I appreciate you having on the show. Thank you for your time. Take care.
Thank you. Bye-bye, David.
Bye-bye.
Bye, Tania. Local news, and talking about building communities, Watford Council have grants for various small-sized organisations.
That's right, Diane. So didn't David sound like he's got a great plan? What a brilliant idea. Sounds really fabulous. Maybe he could, and the group that is leading in Kids Create would be a local group that would have the chance to apply for up to £2,000 to fund a project, a community initiative, or purchase a piece of equipment. It's a small grant from Watford Council, so that'll, I'm sure, cover Croxley, I think. And it's available for any organisation that wants to apply for it. There are lots of them. In fact, one of the councillors said it's easy to underestimate just how many grants are available to help all sorts of community projects. We want to make it easy for people to improve the communities in which they live, and that's why we're holding this funding surgery. The application for the Small Grants Fund doesn't take long to complete, so visit watford.gov.uk/small-grants-fund. If you're eligible for funding, you may be pleasantly surprised. The surgery, which the kids might want to go along to at Kids Create, is hosted by Watford Borough Council and Watford and Three Rivers Trust at Hollywell Community Centre Wednesday next week between 10 a.m. and 1 p.m. Now, I guess kids at Kids Create will be back at school then, but there may be other people who are not, and perhaps it's an appropriate thing for them to get out of school for, to go and learn how to apply for this sort of funding. Companies have been launched with this sort of funding. So Tom Craven launched Papermouth, a local company, about presentations and engagement, fun, parties, that sort of thing. Entertainment, that's the word that I'm looking for. I knew it began with an E. Entertainment and events. He launched with one of these grants and says it's brilliant. So anyone who wants a small grant up to £2,000 to fund a project, community initiative, or purchase a piece of equipment, head along there to Hollywell Community Centre from 10 till 1 on Wednesday the 2nd of November.
Okay, great.
Like Papermouth, I think, is, weren't they one of the local companies that helped with Watford Big Events? I'm sure I've seen Papermouth on the flyers.
I've seen Papermouth somewhere. I wasn't entirely sure, Catherine, but yeah, I was certain I'd seen them somewhere.
Yeah, obviously works, doesn't it? Brilliant.
Doesn't it? We've heard of them.
Okay.
I don't know. I see David still here. David, is that something that would be of interest for Kids Create?
I've written it down in my diary, so I'll see if there's anybody available to come along with me next Wednesday morning. Yeah, I'll see what I can do.
Cool cookies. You see what can happen? Good on you.
Okay. Cassiobury.
So thanks for that.
Later.
Cassiobury, there's plans for a new public consultation on the building of nearly 500 new houses in the area.
That's right. They've let out some pretty pictures for what this new neighbourhood down at Ascott Road might look like. The company behind Cassiobury Station Housing Development is opening a consultation. Now, we spent much of last year, talking about the consultation for the developments down at South Oxy. We got a new one, the new residential quarter by the Cassiobury Station, and the bus interchange is due to open next to the site. There's going to be 6,500 new homes, new blocks of affordable flats, and an area of business stuff going on down there as well, business and employment opportunities. So all of that's coming out, and we get a chance to talk about it, give our opinions at two public exhibitions to be held at Ascott Road Community Free School, Ascott Road Community Free School, on Wednesday, November the 2nd, from 5 till 8 p.m. and Saturday, November the 5th, from 11 a.m. till 4 p.m. I guess if you go to that one, you'll just be in time to go to a fireworks night event fairly close by, shortly afterwards.
Exactly. I think this is one that could run, and it could well replace the planning initiative for South Oxy. It wouldn't be a Linford Road show if we didn't have planning initiative announcements.
Thanks very much, Diane.
That's okay. Now, finally, the new road is going to be open to Watford Hospital.
Yeah, blooming building work. Yes, the new road to Watford Health Campus, as they're calling it, is going to be open very shortly. Now, when is it? When's it going to be open?
16th of November.
16th, that's right. It's going to be called Thomas Sawyer Way. Now, I read that and my immediate thought was a literary one, I'm afraid. Tom Sawyer, it's not. It's Thomas Sawyer, who, let me just get this information right, who was in the army. He was in the forces. Here we go. He was a Watford resident who lived in Blackwell Drive, close to the campus scheme. Was killed in Afghanistan in 2009, the tender age of 26. He was in the Royal Artillery. Tender age of 26.
Yeah. So
the Health Campus Partnership. Sorry?
So the road is linking from back down by B&Q, isn't it, all the way through to the health campus. And it's the one that we talked about last year, because when they were building it, they had to close part of the road down to the industrial estate, didn't they, down at the bottom.
Yeah, it caused loads and loads of problems for lots of people living down in that area, Diane. And it's now about to be open. I remember one discussion that we had that was about whether it was only going to be open for the emergency vehicles. Don't know. Have you got any new update in that?
No, I haven't. And I know that was an idea under consideration, but I think it got pushed out into the long grass, as it were. And I guess it's a case of, well, we'll see what happens when they finally open the road.
Yeah, as far as I know, it is still for hospital personnel and the ambulances. Yeah, I don't think it's going to be for public use at all.
Okay. What from what I've read today, it sounded like it would be for hospital personnel and the emergency vehicles. There were thousands of people that were going to be able to use it. But it didn't sound like it was public for everybody.
Yeah, that sounds about right, I think. That's what I've heard too.
There's also an area up there that's going to be for business. So, again, that's another part of the business development up there happening.
Yeah, I mean, this is all coming back to the farm terrace allotments and that sort of scheme that we've talked about. And indeed, Chris interviewed Sarah Jane Trebar 18 months ago now, I think, when it was hot news. And I know it's been back in court again, and they're now still waiting for a final decision.
Are they? I was going to ask about that. They're still waiting, are they?
That's my understanding.
Okay.
Now, it's only about 7 weeks till Christmas, and Watford have announced their Christmas light switch on dates and who's doing it and everything.
Yes, so in Watford here, we've got Thursday the 10th of November, there's going to be the Snow King and the Snow Queen in a magical celebration as they switch on the lights. So the activities are starting at 4:30 up here at this end of town, up by the pond. There's going to be dancers, a Jack Frost juggler. I wonder if he's juggling Jack Frost or if he's Jack Frost, who's also a juggler. There you go. And a performance by children from Watford Jigsaw's Performing Arts Group. The finale will be a four-person fire show. And then I think things move down the other end of town, and the big switch on will be at 6 p.m. Down at the Into Centre. Parking is free from 4 p.m. The big switch on finale has got Radio 1's Chris Stark as the switch on person and Watford FC players. So the area covered by the lights is extended, it appears, by the Watford bid team. We've spoken about the Watford bid before, the business improvement district, and they've teamed up with the council and the new white lighting scheme, classic lighting scheme, my favourite, sounds good, will cover Market Street, King Street, Town Hall Square and the Peace Hospice, in addition to the High Street and the parade areas that have always been part of it. Town Hall Square, Diane, is that up here in front of the Town Hall?
I believe, yes, that is. It's the area between the Town Hall and the library.
Very good. It's going to be lots of lights. It's going to be lovely.
Yeah. Very briefly, if you're trying to get hold of the Watford Observer this week, you might have a physical copy. You might have trouble getting hold of it today.
Yeah, apparently there was an accident yesterday over Reading sort of way. There's somebody still in hospital at the John Radcliffe, according to this latest update. Life-threatening injuries. They bashed together a Ford and a van that was carrying Watford Observers. So, yeah, you might have difficulty finding a hard copy of the Watford Observer. Find it online instead.
Okay. Three Rivers District Council have used their powers to extend a closure order to tackle antisocial behaviour.
Yes. This was an interesting report that I read here. So there's a flat at Barnley in Mill End. I'm not sure where that is. I don't know whether that's around here or actually it was St Albans Magistrates Court that granted this extension, because this particular flat was being used for antisocial behaviour, which from what I can read in the report looks to be alcohol related. It's probably a bit of noise and lots of people going backwards and forwards. But yeah, what they've done is they've said that only certain people, and that's certain people from the council or the police, etc., and the resident in this particular flat are able to be there. Anyone else can get arrested for being there. So, interesting use of the law, I thought. But yeah, there you go.
Okay, that's great. Thank you for that. And then there's an exporting event which we've talked about in the past, but I think it's worth mentioning again. If you're thinking of exporting, there's a training event happening fairly locally.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, I remember talking about this before. I thought I did. I couldn't remember whether it was on L4G TV, Diane. So, yeah, thank you for confirming my memory was right. It's a free morning workshop. It's run by Hertfordshire Chamber of Commerce and the Department for International Trade. They're there to help you to understand common pitfalls, prepare for handling export orders, getting extra help, and expanding your markets abroad. It's going to be held on the, I had difficulty reading it before, on the 2nd of November at Bio Park in Welwyn Garden City. And there we go, that's it. Yes, Bio Park, Welwyn Garden City, in the morning, 9 a.m. registration, 9:30 start, finishes at 1, and includes lunch, and it's free. What more could you want? If you're wanting to export, get yourself down there.
Exactly. Now, two councils, Hertsmere Borough Council and Hertfordshire County Council, both say they want us to contribute to a survey as to how council tax money is spent. Shall we start with Hertsmere, and then we'll talk about Hertfordshire County Council afterwards?
Okay, well, they're both asking us the same sort of thing. Nice to have your opinion asked for, isn't it? Interesting sort of way of involving the community in deciding how council money is being spent. So we get an opportunity to have a say in exactly that. More meals on wheels, although that's probably provided some other way now. Do we want more care? Do we want more police? Do we want more whatever you want? More people to look after our parks? Whatever the range of services that you would like to be increased or reduced, then Hertfordshire and Hertsmere Council want your opinions. Times council funding has reduced, so there isn't enough money to go round according to the current system. So if you want to have a say in how it's spent on the on giving your opinion through these surveys, it's called in Hertsmere a participatory budgeting exercise. It's going to ask residents in face-to-face interviews and an online thing to give their views. So the online will be promoted to residents through the free News for You e-alerts, Facebook and Twitter, and you can apply to be one of the face-to-face people by approaching the council through their website.
Okay, and there are with Hertsmere, there's a deadline, isn't there? It's about a month away.
Yeah, with Hertsmere, Sunday the 20th of November is the deadline, and anyone, as an added incentive, they really do want your opinion. Anyone who takes part in the survey will be entered into a prize draw to win £100 in M&S vouchers. Just coming up to Christmas, guys.
Exactly. Okay, and Hertfordshire County Council, the deadline is slightly later. It's but it's only online, isn't it?
That's right. It's only an online survey. Sunday the 11th of December, their deadline is. So if you want to have your say, either in Hertsmere or Hertfordshire, sounds like a good way to do it.
Okay, well, thank you for that, Tania. It's quite a lot of news we've covered this week, I think. And sounds as if there's going to be some interesting debate and discussions going on about how council budgets are spent and not spent. And who has some sort of say in it?
That's right, Dan. I think actually the most valuable thing for these surveys is they help us to understand the sorts of decisions that people have to make. How do you choose whether to give the money to care or to give the money to, I don't know, something different, a different part of the council budget? Really, really tough decisions. So go along and see what you think and have your say, because no one's right. There's none of us that are right. It's worth putting your opinion forward.
Okay, that's great. Well, thank you very much for that, Tania. Neil, is he there? He might well be. Okay, obviously not. We'll go to Chris then, and we'll have Chris interviewing his gate.
Hello, Diane.
Hi, Chris.
Now, just as a little bit of a segue from what Tania was talking about there, just so happens that I've put the December, January, February and March over £500 expenditure up on the Southwest Herts community communications hub site. So if you want to go and see what the council are actually spending, over £500 invoices in any one given month, you can go and find that on our hub website now. The bit that is frustrating is that it goes up till March 2016. So actually, they're not actually, they say they should have that up probably within a minimum of 2 months, 2 months out of date. But we're talking March here was the last one. So they're a bit behind, but there's some very interesting statistics on there, which, for example, about £350,000 being spent on bed and breakfast in any given month for people who clearly haven't got council houses or places to live. So there's an awful lot of money being spent in ways that we perhaps wouldn't have assumed the money's going. It's worth having a look. I put them up there just so it can get the conversation going. I also interestingly note there that the only count, well, Hertsmere of asking people how they want to spend their money. I don't think Watford have asked, have they?
Well, they haven't publicised it if they have, but sometimes what we've noticed from the past is what happens in Three Rivers 1 month. Tanya then reports on it happening in Watford or Hertsmere the following month, and then the third council the month after that.
Be interesting to see whether Watford, but I'd be quite curious as to see, I put a note on there, who should we contact to get more up-to-date information? Because clearly March is quite a long time ago.
Yes, it is, isn't it? But this, we're talking about this because there's a figure going around from the Cassiobury Park Lodge, Cassiobury Lodge Committee, which gives a figure to the cost of the new railings along the Rickmansworth Road and end of Cassiobury Park.
Yeah, and that's of course where I am. So I'm going to put the screen on to the front screen so you can see where I am. And actually, it's all rather nice down here. This is our lovely, amazing Cassiobury Park, of course. So Rickmansworth Road is behind me here. You can see the traffic this time of night is quite busy. And they've erected these railings, which you can see here, these rather fetching black railings. And this development has been done by in conjunction with the lottery fund, as you can see there. So a bit of an advert for those guys. Now, Kevin Francis has mentioned that this development has been a £250,000 investment. Now, interestingly enough, the Cassiobury Park gates that they're trying to get resurrected would be somewhere over there in the distance, but not far away from where we are here. Now, I don't know whether you remember what this used to look like, but there was always like a flower bed there, and there were a couple of flower beds here which have been now changed into, well, they're still flower beds, but they're a little bit different to the way they were. And we've got, you know, like this flower bed here, and we've got this anti-slip surface here. And some, I don't know if you can see this now, but they've still got some gates up here, but we've got a flower bed here, and this sign up here, which tells us all about Cassiobury Park. So this is like the entrance, if you like, now to the park, and it's got all the different features of the park and everything else. And that black railing continues behind this other railing, which is going to be taken away, I'm sure, at some point. And we've got some plaques like this one, which is this is telling us where the Cassiobury gates used to be, right? And it's got a picture of them and a little bit of information about those gates. So I don't know whether that wall there that you can see in the background was actually part of the original construction or not, actually, but maybe Kevin Francis will be able to give us some more information on that. But allegedly, this development here in its entirety has been best part of a quarter of a million to do, which, interestingly enough, I was talking to someone while Tania was on, who said 4 days of Wayne Rooney, basically, is the same value as this park development. Which is interesting. I mean, I think those trees there, those flat trees there, are new as well. So, yes, it's definitely an improvement on what was here, because there was no entrance to the park at all before. It was just an open space. You could just walk in anywhere. And now they're obviously focusing people into to going down these two paths here, rather than walking across the grass. But it's not the Cassiobury Park gates that we know of old, but you know, that still rumbles on in the background. So we'll wait and see what happens with that. But anyhow, that's what's going on here, Diane.
Okay, then that fence they've put up there looks as if it's got some sort of at least echo of some period features from when the gates were probably there.
What, you mean those black ones?
Yeah, I mean, it looks like a new, I mean, it's a new fence, but it doesn't look like it's a new fence. They're trying to be sympathetic to the age of the park, you know, to the 1930s.
I guess you would probably say they're not modern styling, but I can assure you they are brand new. Let's have a quick look, shall we?
That's what I meant. I mean,
here we are. I'm showing you now some of the some of the features of these gates. Someone I saw comment on Facebook said, and they've spoilt it by putting up those cheap looking railings. I have to be honest. I'm just going to try. You can actually climb on them. So if someone was desperate to get over the fence and run across the park, they could do so quite easily. They're not as sturdy as you might think. But hey-ho, who am I? I'm not a fence expert.
Okay, well, thank you for that, Chris. Just very briefly, Kevin Francis, you mentioned the name a couple of times. He's been on the show connected with both the Cassiobury Lodge Gatehouse Appeal and also the Classic Car rallies, hasn't he?
Yeah, obviously he's a massive Watford fan. He does loads of stuff for Watford, and you know, and he's got a real keen interest in what goes on here. And yeah, if you consider that what they're talking about is a £1.5 million project to rebuild the gates, you know, that is a heck of a good value for money project when you compare it with what's been spent here. If anybody's interested in knowing a bit more about what's going on at Cassiobury Park and in the lodge and the cottages and all the different bits and pieces and the histories of Cassiobury Park, then do go on to the Cassiobury Park Gates Facebook page. I think they've got, I don't know, 3,000 pictures on there now or something. A load of information, and he's becoming a real local historian, really.
Okay.
Am I here now, or can you hear me or not? Hello.
We're losing.
I can hear you.
I can hear you. I can't hear Diane.
Am I here now?
Oh,
man, you're breaking up all the time.
Can you hear Diane?
Okay, well, I'm just about done here, really, I think. So I will leave you to enjoy the rest of the show.
Okay, thanks, Chris.
Cheers. Bye now.
Bye. Bye. Neal. Thank you, Chris.
Hello.
Hi, Neal. Talking of Watford fans, you're one, aren't you?
Indeed.
Okay. Now, earlier in the week, Watford made headline news after a story broke in the Daily Telegraph.
Yes, the Telegraph seemed to have it in for Premier League football clubs at the moment. They broke the story about the England manager, Sam Allardyce. And they, unfortunately, Watford have been dragged into some shenanigans. It turns out that Daily Telegraph investigated that when Gino Pozzo took over the club in 2014, they used some forged bank documents to prove how much money he was worth. And they're under investigation now by the league. We were in the Football League at the time. It's the Football League that are doing the investigation. So quite bad news, really.
Okay, so is it a storm in a teacup? Is it something that could have major implications on Watford? What's happening next, and what's the outcome? Possible outcomes.
So Watford are having a internal review investigation to see what's going on, and the league will have an investigation. It's big press, and it's bad press for Watford, and we don't really need that. But the likely outcome will be a fine. All the newspapers are saying a points deduction, but the Football League have no jurisdiction over Premier League clubs, so they actually couldn't put a points fine on us if they want, as far as I understand. They can do a fine, so we could get a fine. Obviously, we're a club with a lot of money now compared to what we used to be, and a fine will be absorbed by the owners, I'm sure. In past cases, there has been threatened, so if you get relegated, there will be a points deduction waiting for you, but that's never happened as far as I'm aware. So it will blow over, but it's more bad press than anything else, really. And
what was in this forged letter?
And it was very strange because the chairman, Reaver, was tasked with getting the letter from the bank saying that Gino Pozzo had enough money to fill Watford's fixtures for that season. And that's a legal requirement to take over a football club. And for some reason, the third party. He got a forged letter from HSBC Investment Bank. The problem is, it was quite easy to find out it was a forgery because they actually don't deal with football clubs or businesses. So it was an obvious forgery. Why he got a forgery is still to come to light. And unfortunately, the chairman, Mr. Reaver, who was tasked with this to get the third party to do it, he's probably going to be the one who's under the most pressure at the club.
I mean, it's a bit ironic because Watford invested something like £21 million in the time since that letter was produced.
Yeah, they've invested three times the amount that they were asked to provide they had. So that will go in our favour, the fact that he wasn't lying about actually he had enough money. So it wasn't the fact that he was trying to say I had more money than I didn't. It's just a really inexplicable why this third party did this.
Okay, but it's also brought about other news about Watford, and that is that they were pursued by HMRC and the number of loan players they had. So it wasn't just newspapers who were complaining about them.
Yeah, and it's the Telegraph. So not sure what they've got against Watford, because this is actually a non-story as far as I'm concerned. Because Watford were investigated and they were found to have done nothing wrong. This comes back to when we had loan players working on registered players, temporary employees or permanent employees. The HRC were investigating us because we had so many loan players, and Watford were found to be done nothing wrong. It was a bit of sensational headlines by the newspapers. It's a non-story of mine.
Okay, well, look, it's a really bad line. So I'm going to jump to a review of last week's game. Neil,
it wasn't the best game. I think Swansea would have been Swansea feeling more aggrieved. They had some good chances to score. Yeah, we were lucky to get away with the point, I think.
Okay, well, and the game tomorrow, they're playing Hull.
Yeah, now Hull are on a really bad trot, and I think my feeling is we will keep that going. I think we'll win, and I think we'll win quite comfortably, 2-3 They had a good start to the season, Hull, but they've got a tiny squad. They've got injuries, and we've got Jan Matt back in the squad, which is really good news. He broke his shoulder in September. Back in the squad, so that's really good news. And I think it'll just be too good for them.
Okay, Neil, you're breaking up. Shall we? So, your prediction for tomorrow?
2-0 to Watford.
Okay. Kings Langley, they had a mixed week with a draw last Saturday.
Yes, draw last Saturday and a loss in the week. They're still sitting around mid table. But yeah, they got to pick up more points than that for the rest of the season.
Yeah, there was an article in the Observer saying they're going to have big budget cuts from their playing staff.
Yeah, the managers aren't too happy about this because they were unaware. I think this is due to the fact that they haven't managed to find a new owner, which they were hoping to do. No manager wants to play a budget cut.
Right. Okay, and tomorrow they're at home to Heybridge Swifts in the FA Trophy, first qualifying round. The prize winning is £2,500 for that.
Yeah, if they get through, that would be big for Watford, definitely. Kings Langley, definitely.
Okay, Fullerians managed to score 48 points and still lost.
Wow, what a score this year. They managed to be disappointed. 48 points you expect to win a game, but unfortunately they conceded 71, which was in a error-strewn defensive performance.
And tomorrow they're at home to North Wellingham. How do you think that one's going to go?
North Wellingham has seen fourth in the table, so it's going to be a tough game for Fullerians.
Okay. We're having some sound issues, which is why we're rushing through the sports stuff. I'm not quite sure if it's my end or Neil's end, but hopefully it will resolve itself. Golf. Callum Shinkwell is on a good place to be on his road to the race for Dubai.
Yeah, he's in 74th place at the moment after coming 17th in the Portugal Masters last week. It looks like he's going to qualify, which will be the pinnacle of his career so far. So let's hope he does. And we'll see, because once you get into there, that's the big money. You're making the big money tournaments there.
Okay. And finally on golf, Matt Wallace had another win last weekend.
Yeah, Matt Wallace, we've been talking about him all season. Sixth tournament of the season. Well, the papers say confirming his top of the Merit League. Well, it was always certain he was going to be top of Merit League. He's got almost twice as many points as anyone else, and he only actually played 9 tournaments, won 6 of them, and everyone else has played 15, 16 and 17 tournaments, so absolutely dominant in the ones that he played.
So what's next for him?
He'll move on to the Challenger Tour, and no doubt with such results he'll start getting invites to big tournaments, the occasional tournaments like Portugal Masters and like the British Masters. Hopefully he'll get some invites to those.
Okay. Anthony Joshua, last week you talked about how he might fight Vladimir Klitschko for the world title. That's not happening.
Yeah, unfortunately, as we were discussing last week, it hasn't happened. The WBO or WBA haven't sanctioned a fight. And the rumour was that Klitschko wouldn't fight without one of those belts on the line. And lo and behold, he now has a minor injury that is stopping him fighting in December. No coincidence, I'm sure. It's just an easy get out. And unfortunately, the names being bandied around fighting Anthony Joshua don't seem to be particularly well-known fighters. So not going to quite be the spectacle it was going to be, but there will still be a fight on December 10th. And Anthony Joshua will be defending his IBF crown. And we'll just have to wait for the name of who that's going to be.
Okay. That's it for the sport at the moment. Thank you very much for that, Neil. Sorry, the sound broke up. But we got the gist of everything that you wanted to say about the sport this week. And we will, of course, hold you to your prediction about 2-0 for Watford. I can't remember what you predicted for the Swansea game, but I think you...
I predicted a draw, but I predicted 1-0.
Yeah, but yeah, exactly. But yeah, well, enjoy the game tomorrow. And thank you very much for your contribution this week.
Enjoy the rest of the show. See you soon.
See you soon. Bye, Neil. Thank you. Hi, Catherine.
Hello.
It's just me and Dee again.
It is, yes. Getting echoey in here, isn't it? Literally.
It was. It was very weird how the sound dropped out. But
it was, yeah. It got better, though, so it's fine.
It did. Charity news. Shall we start with Lights of Love at the Peace Hospice in December?
Yes. Indeed, yes. This is Peace Hospice Care. This is an annual event that they hold around this time. It's going to be on Wednesday, the 7th of December, 7 for 7.30, outside Watford Town Hall. It's Lights of Love. It's a community event to remember and celebrate the lives of loved ones, obviously with a connection to the Peace Hospice Care as well. Everyone is invited to be a part of the Lights of Love commemorations, remember and celebrate those we've lost. And it's an important ceremony to honour the memories of loved ones. And a lot of people find comfort in being part of the Lights of Love commemorations. You can send a dedication message, which will be displayed at the Lights of Love ceremony and on the Wall of Remembrance at the hospice throughout December. You can attend the ceremony on Wednesday, the 7th of December. As I say, it's outside the Watford Town Hall in Town Hall Square, I believe, at 7 for 7.30. It's open to the whole community with readings, music, refreshments, and the chance to dedicate a light as they switch on the Lights of Love tree. And you can also give a donation in memory of a loved one so that they can offer the same caring service to other families when they're most in need. So you can have a look at this online. If you go to peacehospice.co.uk, then you'll find all the details there. There's a registration form, or you can phone them up on 01923 335371 and speak to the team.
And, of course, Michael Sobel will do something similar, and we talked about that last week.
Yes.
They have their Light Up a Life event on the 26th and 27th of November. We did talk about it last week, which is why we haven't.
Yes. Yes. I got a little confused there because that was not my next window up. But yes, they do a similar thing, don't they?
No, what is your next thing up is Halloween Colour Dash.
Indeed it is, spot on. Absolutely. Yes, as you say, this is Michael Sobel, Halloween Colour Dash. No, this is not just a summer event anymore, it's for Halloween as well, with all their spooky colours. Lots of greens, yellows, oranges and blacks, I'm sure. Okay, so online entry is now closed for this event, but you can turn up on the day and sign up. It's the same price, but you must register by 10 o'clock in order to take part. Fun starts at 11 o'clock, and this is on Sunday the 30th of October, so that's this Sunday, at the Michael Sobel Centre at Mount Vernon Hospital in Northwood. As I say, the fun starts at 11, but you must register by 10. Each participant can choose to take on one, two, or the full three laps and will be sprayed with ghastly colour as they walk, jog, or run through the colour stations. Sponsorship opportunities are available. Either have a look on the website or call the fundraising team on 020 3826 2353 or 62. Instead of 5-3 on the end. Fancy Halloween dress, prizes up for grabs, there's pumpkin carving competitions, prizes up for grabs, and spooky colour stations. Entry is £20 for adults and £12 for children. No, it isn't. £20 for adults and children 12 plus. Children under 11 is £10. And there is a special family price of £50 for two adults and two children. That's Sunday.
Okay, and there's a Santa Dash with two hospices holding it on successive weekends.
Indeed, yes. Let's go with Michael Sobel again first. This is on the 3rd of December at 12 o'clock. It's at the Michael Sobel Hospice shop in Northwood, and that's in Green Lane. Registration will be held at Northwood Methodist Church, Oaklands Gate, Northwood at 11:15. The Dash, which is approximately 1 mile run, jog, walk, starts at 12 noon. It says Oaklands Gate is the second road on the left-hand side opposite the car park in Green Lane. So adult entry fee includes a Santa costume. Child under 16 includes a novelty item. So adults is £20, children under 16 is £10. Registration form is online. Go to michaelsobelhospice.co.uk.
Okay, and...
I was going to say, the other Santa Dash is the Hospice of St Francis. This is at Riverside, Hemel Hempstead. It's on the 11th of December, so the following weekend, 9 in the morning till 11 in the morning. It says 9, I'm guessing that's for registration, because it says the event starts at 10 then. So gather up your friends and family and join the Sea of Super Santas to walk, sprint, scoot or jog around their festive 2.5 mile Santa Dash through Hemel Hempstead. They'll supply, again, the Santa suits, reindeer ears for the little ones, and they'll greet you at the finish line with a mince pie, hot drink and a shiny medal. Registration is £15 for adults, £5 for children, or bring the whole family, including the dog, for just £35. Again, you can register online if you go to www.stfrancis.org.uk. You'll find all the details there, and that's on the 11th of December.
Yes, and the reason we're mentioning the St Francis one as well is that this is the first week, I think, where you can actually register.
Ah, right. Perfect.
Great. Now, if you want to register, and it's a shame that Tanya's had to go, because I know that she did this event last year, and so did Chris, actually. Yeah. That's the St Albans Sleep Out. They did it on behalf of the Decorum Homeless Charity, but New Hope, and one of 11 charities take part in this event this year.
Yes, absolutely, yes. There's lots of groups that take part in this, raise money for this particular one. As you say, it's the New Hope, which is a homeless charity in Watford. This is St Albans Sleep Out. It's on Friday the 2nd of December, 9 in the evening, through till Saturday the 3rd of December at 7 in the morning. So it's an overnight stay, basically, in the Cathedral and Abbey Church of St Albans, in and around the grounds, I think. I think somewhere outside, somewhere inside, depending on your level of stamina. It's an event where people really do think about the plight of homeless people and actually doing something, a sponsored event to raise some money to help the charities that help the homeless people. As I say, the event is on the 2nd of December through to the 3rd of December. Find out more details online if you go to newhope.org.uk. Then you'll find registration details there. The registration pack isn't available yet, but if you are interested in taking a part, then let them know by emailing events@newhope.org.uk, and then they can get the information to you. So, another worthwhile cause.
Okay. On a different note, WeBass are making a membership offer as part of their attempt to attract more members.
Absolutely. This is the Watford and Bushy Arts Society, or WeBass, was it you called them?
Yes.
Cool. Please come and join us. The next meeting is the time to do it, as you can have November, December, and all the meetings and opportunities in 2017 for the usual membership fee of £28, payable at the November meeting, whereas membership normally runs from January through to December, so you're getting something extra free there. Special offer is only open to new members or previous members who have lapsed for 3 years or more. It's been going for a while. It's welcome to all, with no selection process. It means that members include a wide spectrum of people, ranging from gifted professionals to absolute beginners. There's a song about that. And those with just an interest in art. Now, I believe there is actually an exhibition going on at the moment. Is that right, Diane?
Well, the Watford Camera Club have an exhibition that carries on, it's been on this week, and it continues this weekend until 5 p.m. on Sunday when we take it down.
Fantastic. Just to reiterate, this is Watford and Bushy Arts Society. Go along to the November meeting. They meet at Tennant Hall, Watford Grammar School for Girls, Ladies Close. The next meeting is, I'm trying to see a date here, Diane.
1st of November.
1st of November, okay. And it's at 7 for 7:30 start. Visitors are welcome. Do go and join.
Because they always meet on the first Tuesday of the month.
Aha, there you go. Perfect.
Okay, now it's coming up to Halloween and fireworks, as we've been alluding to several points throughout the show. The first is firework displays that are taking place this weekend.
Gosh, yes. Now there's an awful lot of these, so I'm going to pick out one or two. If you go to threerivers.gov.uk/news/firework displays, then you'll find the whole list of them there. I'll post the link up at the end of the show. There's firework displays from St Mary's Primary School. Bushy Met Police Club is always a good one. That's on Sunday evening at 6 in the evening. Tickets, advance booking, adults £5, children £2, or on the day, adults £7, children £3. And so it's always a good display there. Russell School have one, St Joseph's Roman Catholic Primary School have one, York Mead Primary School, Abbots Langley firework display, that's at Manor House Playing Fields, Gallows Hill Lane. That's Friday the 4th of November from 6:30 onwards. And they've got music as well, music and rides for children from 6:30. Cassiobury Park fireworks event, always a huge event. And I happen to know that it's actually on the same night as Watford Beer Festival. And very often people combine the two. It's a rather nice evening out. That's on Saturday the 5th of November, 6 in the evening through till 8:30. So it's usually a pretty spectacular. Leave the car at home, though. Do walk, don't drive. Croxley Green Community Club, they've got a firework display. That's on the 5th of November. Maple Cross Junior School, they've got one. Sacred Heart fireworks display, Merry Hill Road in Bushy. That will be a spectacular one, actually. On the top of the hill, should be able to see that from miles around. So there's lots and lots and lots of firework displays going on. So if you go to the Three Rivers, threerivers.gov.uk, search for firework displays, and you'll find all the ones in the area. One little note I would say is please don't let them off in your garden. So many people have said already that pets get scared, kids are in bed, they get woken up after 11, 12 o'clock in the evening with people letting fireworks off at home. So please don't go to an organised display. It's much safer.
Okay, thank you. Now, entertainment, and it's horns, and it's the horns pub. We'll start with there, and it's reggae night with the DJ this evening.
Absolutely. I know this is one of your favourites, Diane. I dare say you'll be down there a bit later on, boogieing away. Just like you're doing now, and nobody can see. This is reggae night with DJ Selector Sticks, music by Selector Sticks from Radio RJR and DJ Dave Hollywood. As you rightly say, this is this evening down at the Horns. It's free before 9:30, £3 from 9:30 until 1 in the morning. So get on down.
Okay, and then tomorrow they have the Natalies?
The Natalies. Yeah, I'm guessing they're both called Natalie. Maybe that's where the name of the band came from. Last Halloween, the band all dressed up. This year we had the same with the Natalies. So this is tomorrow evening. There's a bottle of wine for the best dressed customer. Yay! Halloween at the Horns in Watford. The Natalies are a Hearts-based four-piece pop rock indie covers band, and they play classics from late 60s to the present day with a heavy nod to the 80s and 90s. Sounds like fun. It's free to attend, 9 o'clock onwards, right through till 1 in the morning. Fabulous.
Okay, and that's Saturday, and then on Sunday they have a gig Sunday afternoon between 4 and 7 with Big Al and the Blistering Buicks.
Yeah, Big Al and the Blistering Buicks. Welcome return for a rocking band with the dynamic vocals of Big Al Reed. Big Al has been a professional entertainer that's been wowing audiences throughout the world with his comedy and music, hopefully, as well, has now gone back to his musical roots and formed the Blistering Buicks with the fabulous Leigh Haggerty and Pete Kerr on guitars, with Big Man doubling on guitars as well. So this is from 4 in the afternoon through till 7 in the evening, and it's free, and that's on Sunday at the Horns.
Okay, now moving on to Watford Coliseum. Let's start with the event tomorrow night in the Watford Philharmonic Society.
Exactly, yes. A little bit of classical music for us for a change. This is the first concert of the 2016-17 season, and there's obviously lots more to come. If you get the new Watford Coliseum brochure is out now, and also you can look online and see what's coming up. During a four-year period commemorating the centenary of World War I, several of their concerts included works reflecting aspects of conflict on the lives of many families and individuals, both then and now. Remembrance, which is the title of this concert, is a programme of music reflecting on the 100th anniversary of the Battle of the Somme and features Massenet's Meditation de Te, played on the Western Front violin, and Bruck and Mozart's wonderful Requiem. So this is Saturday the 29th of October, so it's 7:30 in the evening. There are still tickets available, priced from £17.50 to £20.50. Under 19s are £6.50, bargain.
Okay, and then on Sunday, the Coliseum have got something completely different. They've got a screaming.
Halloween screaming of Beetlejuice and Silence of the Lambs. Now, having looked on their site, now actually Beetlejuice is sold out, but Silence of the Lambs you can still get tickets for. So obviously two cult Halloween films to get you ready for the 31st of October. They'll be showing at the Beetlejuice earlier on and Silence of the Lambs at 8:30. Go online and get tickets for this one. They're £5 per screening. I was right first time. Meals, food and snacks will be available for purchase in the cafe bar.
Okay, we talked about this last week, but it still continues to run tonight and tomorrow, and that's James and the Giant Peach.
Yes, is it? I haven't actually got that one up. Let me go find it. Hold on. I had Pete's Dragon up, you see. So this is theatre, isn't it? James the Giant Peach. Join James's insect friends for an unforgettable giant peach of an adventure to celebrate the centenary of Roald Dahl's birth. There's been lots of things to celebrate Roald Dahl's birth over the last year, and this is one of them. Tickets are still available. Friday 28th, that's today, at 6 o'clock this evening. Better get your skates on for that one. Tomorrow at 2, and then Saturday also at 6 in the evening. Tickets are £8. Rumour tickets, if you're aged between 16 and 25, are just £5. Absolute bargain.
Okay, and Pete's Dragon.
Yes.
Sunday morning.
I'll try and get back on my screen now. There we go. A reimagining of the classic family fun. Pete's Dragon follows the fantasy adventure of a 10-year-old orphan named Pete and his new friend Elliot, a surprisingly gentle dragon hiding in the mysterious depths of the American forest. This is lovely. Again, if you go on the Watford Palace website, you can see a clip of it, get a little trailer, teaser trailer for it, and then go along and see the whole thing. On Sunday, it's 11 in the morning. It's one of their Palace family screenings, so it's only £4 to go and see it. It's at 11 o'clock Sunday morning. Lovely.
Okay, then Sunday evening, there's King Lear.
Yes, something a little bit more dramatic. This is a delayed live performance from the Royal Shakespeare Company. I won't go into the story of King Lear. There's a lot of drama in it. I think there's a lot of death, there's a lot of drama, and probably some happy moments too. Classic stuff. Anthony Scher returns to the RSC to play King Lear, one of the greatest parts written by Shakespeare. So it's epic and it's powerful. It's on Sunday. It's at 7 o'clock in the evening, £15, no concessions.
Okay, and then on Monday, the Palace is showing the film Lights Out.
Yeah, this looks interesting. When her little brother Martin is drawn into the same horror that haunted her as a child, Rebecca, played by Teresa Palmer, is brought face to face with a sinister entity that only emerges in darkness. A supernatural chiller to celebrate Halloween, directed by David Sandberg. So, spooky goings on. Again, you can see the trailer on Watford Palace Theatre's site, showing the film on Monday, 31st of October, Halloween night, at 7:30 in the evening. It's £8, concessions £6.50. Rumour tickets are £4.
Okay, and on a slightly lighter note, you have Jess and Joey Forever playing Monday, Wednesday, and Tuesday and Wednesday this week at the Palace.
Yes, you've got to cheer yourself up with this one. This is Jess and Joe Forever, as you say. It's the Farnham Maltings in association with Orange Tree Theatre. It's an independent theatre company. Meet Jess and Joe. They want to tell their story. It follows the lives of these two individuals. Joe is a Norfolk born and bred, wears wellies. Jess holidays there with her au pair and is slightly too tubby for her summer dresses. It follows their lives as they grow up. It covers several summer holidays. It's billed as being an unusual coming-of-age tale that explores rural life and what it means to belong somewhere, if you can really belong anywhere. So it's a layered and thoughtful play about finding your place in the world when you only know a small quarter of it. So this looks really interesting. Do have a look at some of the reviews. It's got great reviews, quirky, funny, moving, vivid and touching. And again, there's a little trailer of some of their rehearsal times online. Tickets are £14. Concessions are £2 off. Tuesday the 1st of November at 8 o'clock and Wednesday the 2nd of November also at 8 o'clock. Tickets are available.
Okay, and on Thursday evening there's a delayed live performance from the National Theatre of the Threepenny Opera.
Yeah. The Threepenny Opera, or the Threepenny Opera, depending on how you want to pronounce it. Mac the Knife is back in town. A darkly comic new take on Brecht and Weill's raucous musical broadcast live from the stage of the National Theatre. London scrubs up for the coronation. The thieves are on the make. The whores are on the pull. The police cutting deals to keep it all out of sight. Mr. and Mrs. Peachum are looking forward to a bumper day in the beggary business. But their daughter didn't come home last night, and it's all about to kick off. So this looks fantastic. Olivier Award winner Rory Kinnear, who's done lots of things in the West End, alongside Rosalie Craig as Polly Peachum. There's other names to have a read of there as well. Have a look on the website. Again, you can see a little clip of it, some of the rehearsal times they've had there. It's a bold, anarchic production, apparently, brought to you by a creative powerhouse. So this is Thursday, 3rd of November, 7:30 in the evening, £15, no concessions.
Okay, and next Friday, finally from the Palace, next Friday and Saturday, there is a play.
Yep.
I'm not quite sure, called How to Date a Feminist.
Indeed, this is Laundry Productions presenting How to Date a Feminist. Kate likes her men tall, dark and smouldering. She has a fatal attraction to bad men. Then she meets Steve. Steve is a feminist. Can she overcome her lack of love of lipstick, cupcakes and Heathcliff? Can he forego the ethical confetti and learn to be a little more ravishing in bed? Can the two of them reinvent romance for the 21st century? How to Date a Feminist is a hilarious theatrical spin on the Hollywood rom-com and a passionate modern love story. It's also followed by a question and answer session afterwards as well. This is on Saturday the 5th of November and it's 8 o'clock for the performance and say followed by a Q&A afterwards.
Yeah.
On Friday the 4th of November at 8 o'clock, Saturday 5th of November at 2:30 in the afternoon, and then there's the 8 o'clock production in the evening, followed by the Q&A. Tickets £14, concessions £2.
Okay, now Michael Green Dyer by Beatrice Foundation have a wine tasting evening coming up.
Indeed, yes. I can show you a little bit of a poster. I don't know whether you can see that. There we go. Beautifully designed, isn't it, Diane? This is wine tasting. It's at Reason Coffee Shop. It's on Friday the 25th of November, raising money, as you say, for the Michael Green Diabetes Foundation. Tickets are £25, bookable in advance. I have tickets, Diane has tickets, Neil has tickets at the shop as well. So do get in touch with one of us if you fancy coming. They're always a good evening, always good fun, lots of lovely wines to taste and finish up afterwards. So do come and get your tickets as soon as possible because they are selling quite quickly. So do let us know if you want to come.
Okay, that's great. Now, Yellow Comedy, they are doing a gig for the Watford Women's Centre on the 3rd of December.
Yeah, another evening of outstanding comedy. Following on from the fabulous Yellow Comedy Night in March, Watford Women's Centre are delighted to be working with Yellow Comedy again for another night of comedy fundraising. Last time it was to celebrate International Women's Day, and they had an all-women lineup of comedians. This time some male comedians are appearing. Woohoo! A different lineup, but another fun-filled, fantastic night of comedy is promised. Headliner is the most famous and celebrated comedian of Southwest Hearts, Steve Owen Williams, and I've seen him and he's good. Special treat for everyone. We saw him at Attico not that long ago, didn't we? Which was really, really good. Yeah. He made his professional debut at the age of 17. His polite and friendly manner, along with innate ability to communicate and create an innocent sense of fun, has seen him perform alongside many celebrities from the world of showbiz and sports. Steve has made his also made regular TV appearances throughout his long career. He's supported by five other great comedians and Yellow Comedy's master of ceremonies, the very, very funny Andrew Carberry. Doors open 7:15, comedy starts at 8, and this is at the Pump House. So Pump House Theatre and Arts Centre, which is down the end of Lower High Street. It's on Saturday the 3rd of December, 7:15, as I say, for 7:30 start. For 8 o'clock start, rather. Come along.
Yep. And Rosie Holt and John Long are two, and Pete White are three of the supporting acts, along with Sonia Astell and Ariel Suma. Certainly with Rosie and John and Pete, I've seen them a couple of times. They've always been really funny, as has Sonia on one time I've seen them before. So it should be a really good evening with lots of great fun. Tickets are £7 if bought from the Watford Women's Centre, £8 and threepence if they're bought through Eventbrite, or £9 on the door in the evening.
Fabulous. Super duper. And we're going to see Yellow Comedy tonight, aren't we?
We are at LJ's.
Yay! LJ's Coffee Shop, which is up in Bushy, just opposite Bushy Station. Tell you more about it in a minute. This is tonight. Yellow Comedy are there with headliner James Ross. Seen him before too, and he's incredibly funny. Doors open 7:30, comedy starts at 8. James Ross is an award-winning improvisational comedian and founder of Fat Kitten Improv. He's gone solo and currently also duo, and he's very active on the stand-up scene. If you find out more, you can find out more rather on yellowcomedy.uk, all about his details and background. Also appearing tonight are Jack Brooks, Stella Graham, Emily McQuaid, The Monks, Adam Riley, and Will Rowland. And of course, definitely emceed by Yellow Comedy promoter Andrew Carberry, aka Carbs.
Exactly. Have you climbed out the fish tank?
Sorry?
Have you climbed out of the fish tank?
I don't know, have I?
Yes.
I sound fine to me.
Yes. No, what it was is we had that kind of underwater type sound again.
Yes. Oh, I blame the dog for that sort of thing.
Exactly. Dog for next week's Link for Growth events.
Probably. Actually, probably not.
Okay. Well, tomorrow Chris is at Barracuda. It's between 10 and 11:30. Barracuda is the cafe next to the high street entrance to Watford Market. It's a great opportunity for you to go down and speak to Chris and find out more about what Link for Growth is involved with, what it tries to build, and how it tries to help build communities. Tuesday is Link for Drinks at the Royal Oak in Kings Langley with a 7:30 start. And this is the second Link for Langley. If you remember, Rachel Brett came on and talked about the first one a couple of weeks ago. Wednesday morning, there's a Link for Coffee or Coffee Morning at Regis and Clarendon Road. There's no room at Regis, get moved to the Holiday Inn opposite. But at the moment, it looks like it's still a bit Regis. Chris will confirm that nearer the time through Facebook updates or whatever. But it's usually a good event, it's usually very business focused because of where it's held. It's at Clarendon Road, 10 o'clock to 11:30 at Regis. And then on Thursday morning at 9:30 at the Perth coffee shop in Carpenter's Park. There's another link. Coffee there, usually a very well attended event with various people from part of the. So, coming along to meet up and to talk about various things that they're involved with. Do you have a restaurant for us this week?
Sorry. Diane, you were breaking up quite a little bit during that. I think we'll have to post all the links for those Link for Growth things next week. I don't think people will have that link. All right.
You're breaking up quite a lot as well.
Shall I carry on? Can you hear this all right? Yeah, I'm not sure. Okay.
I think we should stop, actually, because it's...
It's
horrible sounding.
Okay,
that's fine. All right, ta-ra, folks. Have a good weekend. We'll get the restaurant review next week if we make Catherine. Okay. Okay, well, yeah, we'll get the restaurant review next week. Or has it all sorted itself out? Catherine, can you hear me?
I can hear you better now. Yeah, I don't know what happened there.
No, I don't. Okay, restaurant review then.
Okay, let's do it. I'll crash through. Okay, my restaurant review is actually LJ's Coffee Bar. So I may have done it before. I don't know. I don't care. I'm doing it again. It's current in my mind. So it's a lovely little coffee place. If you go down Lower High Street towards Butchy Arches, there's a car park. Park in the car park. Get out your car. Walk up the hill, and that's where the coffee shop is. You'll see lots of flats. There's a couple little shops there, and it's right opposite Bushy Station as well. You can't miss it. They do lovely coffee, ethical stuff as well. They get their coffee from the Natural Coffee Company. Both caffeinated and decaf coffee is fair trade and organic, which means that farmers are paid fairly for their products. All their takeaway products are 100% compostable, made by Vegware. So it doesn't just say it on the outside and then the inside you can't recycle. Actually, it's 100% compostable. They only ever use free-range eggs. The produce that they use is of the highest quality and looked after carefully, which earns them 5 stars from Watford Food Hygiene Team in every inspection. That's always good to know. It's a lovely little place. They do food, they do paninis, they do salads. Fantastic coffee, lovely venue, and also venue for yellow comedy. So there's lots of yellow comedy. So there's lots of go and give them a try.
Okay, well, thank you for that, Catherine, and thank you for your contribution on events and everything. Thank you also to Chris for going down and doing the satellite for us. It's again to do. Also, thank you to David Knowles talking to us about his initiative for kids. Interesting, exciting. Thank you for the news. Neal for sports news. We'll be back next week with another great show. If you do want to get in touch with us, then please do write us at L4GSWHearts, at L4GSWHearts. If you've got ideas for show contributions, if you want something publicised, then please do get in touch with us. So I want to thank the trio and thank you for watching and bearing through some technical problems. Bye-bye.